This is a podcast which is slightly special because it's happening in collaboration with YouTube for their global project, Creators for Change. Over the next 13-45 minutes, we're going to be talking about what it means to create safe online spaces for women. So with us, just to introduce the panel, and that is going to be my only role as token male toxic masculine representative. Manaswi, who is a writer at AIB, she's one of our amazing writers. Kuch apna self-introduction wagera tujhko karna hai.
I'm an introvert, I'm going to try talking. Yes.
So through the role of this conversation is to engage Manaswi. We have Karuna Nundy, who's a Supreme Court lawyer, also represents us in a lot of cases because, you know.
You all need it. You guys need it.
We have the one and only Raveena Tandon. Just got into a spat yesterday on Twitter.
So oh, yes. All the time. Yes. All the time. Yes.
We have India's favorite anti-national, Gurmehar Kaur, who is now scared of A4 sheets, I imagine. So yeah. Just be careful.
And I'm Rohan Joshi.
That's a good look. That's a new look.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm a drag queen, so. Yeah,
yeah. So you're taking this workout very seriously.
I am. My other name is Radhika Vaz. I'm a comedian.
So, Raveena, ma'am, I'm going to start with you. Yesterday, you wrote on your blog, you were talking about, you know, the differences between when you used to, in the 90s, not have social media. That the kind of harassment that you used to face on a day-to-day level was very different.
Yeah, so it was in the 90s, we didn't have any way to put forth our side of the story. So whatever the magazine controversial headlines were screaming all across the country, that was what was believed. And even if the magazine or the tabloid wanted to issue an apology, there'd be one thin fine line right at the end of the page. Dhoondte reh jaoge, bhaiya kidhar sorry bola hai. So it was, I mean, there were unbelievable stories. Like, you know, one story actually from a tabloid magazine said that I've had a fight with one of the heroes and I've stood below on the ground floor and he lived on the sixth floor building. On the sixth floor flat, and from down, I have thrown stones on his sixth floor windows and broken every window of his house.
Is it because you were paid less?
I was so good, man. I mean, I was.
Because disparity remained.
No, dude, I was hanging my cape somewhere. Mera aim dekho, yaar. Mera aim dekho.
And you still managed to shoot like six movies in between all of this conundrum that was happening. So it's a
what did I have to do in the 90s? Play the rich spoiled brat, same dialogue, same thing, only costume change. What do you do? So I reached a point when I started doing different stuff, and now I enjoy the kind of cinema I'm doing even today.
But you bring about an interesting point, and Radhika, I wanted to actually come to you with that. Now, given that you do stand up and you're on stage constantly, how do you see the difference in terms of how do you feel the audiences perceive you different in terms of whether it's, say, a male stand-up comic?
If a male comic says sort of the same thing, it's a bit more, you know, it's entertaining, and I think the men in the audience and even some of the
it's
women feel
more comfortable.
Yeah. I say sort of the same thing, and it's there is a discomfort.
On the men's
but
shirts,
yeah, but as a writer performer, that's also my job is to keep on saying shit. Can I say that?
Yeah. Go ahead. Yeah.
There is bakchod on the carpet underneath.
I pointed the same thing, and I said this is AIB.
I'm sorry. I'm very used to being on TV. No, I'm not. No, but like, I just think that back in the day when the media was very limited to just offline, it was celebrities being targeted. Today with social media, if you think about it, you don't even have to be a celebrity. So it's the scope has become of harassing women has actually increased because of this. But someone like Gurmehar, you weren't in that space. But now suddenly, you know, you were ushered into it in a very negative way.
All of a sudden, the reason that we started the campaign was we were talking about student violence. We were talking about safe campuses. We were talking about, you know, that is what we were condemning. And all of a sudden, it just became about everything in my past. And I think that was very problematic. We know the student politics, may violence exists. So why aren't we having that conversation, especially in a university like Delhi University? Are you telling me that I would rather have a conversation discussing this 20-year-old girl, whether she's a nationalist or not, or I would have a prime time channel for debate about violence in a university like DU?
what I do think, because I remember supporting her in one of my tweets, and I said, what is wrong with what she said? I do not support war as well. Mm-hmm. And that was the message she was trying to give about. Now, her very, very important message came out at a time when the surgical strikes and that Pakistan, anti-Pakistan feeling was all around. So that's why everyone jumped on that bandwagon. And
so isn't that then the right time?
You know, I don't think we can pander to sentiments. When people are talking, war is not sacred. People lose families in war. And these are political decisions made by people that all of us have elected, right? So the thing is that I think when somebody like Gurmehar makes a very, very important point, right, a series of important points in a context where a large swath of people disagree with her. And then there is a large swath of people that agree with her, right? All of us supported you. What happens sometimes is there's this very sort of masculinist, tu kaun hoti hai chori chup ho ja.
And also like this can be talked about here, this can't be talked about there. Like we're not supposed to know, you know, and as we're not supposed to know when to say what.
And also, she is a citizen.
Exactly.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. And so when there is a war, and if she disagrees with the war, you know, I mean, not that there was a war, there were sort of skirmishes at the time. I see no reason why at that time that she should not make the point that she's making.
And I think that that's an important point. I actually want to bring Manaswi into this debate. There's a very famous comedian who did a joke about how every YouTube comment eventually devolves into you are Pakistani and you drink cow piss, even if it's a cat video. Yeah. So how do you as a user react to seeing, say, fake news or seeing something like, you know, the dramatic sort of trolling that happened of Gurmehar? Yeah.
If you're part of a YouTube video, you'll always have a comment like, would love to fuck the girl at oat, whatever, seconds, you know. So you're constantly sexualized in that. That is the only way you're allowed to exist on the internet. Mm-hmm. The minute you want to have an opinion is when everybody has a problem. I mean, I think it's irrelevant whether you agree with a particular debate or not. Okay, everybody has the right to voice it. It just needs to exist. And it's people who are not willing for you to exist on the internet at all. Because if you're constantly going to be trolled and you're constantly going to be sexualized, then it's an unsafe space and you don't want to exist on that platform anymore.
Talking about fake videos and like fake news, there was this video of a girl dancing and drinking in a car. And they are like, truth of Gurmehar exposed, she's drinking and dancing in a car. One, that girl's not me. Okay, second, when a woman puts their opinion forward, the best way to shut her up is defamation. It's character assassination. My mother brought the video to me and I'm like, this is not me. She's like, I know. But the whole point is, whether it was me or whether it was not, what's the problem?
Yeah. Pretty much all I write or tweet about is patriarchal issues, you know, gender roles, how they should be changing. So they come at you. It doesn't really matter. Yeah. Like, do you find a difference between how when men say something and women say something, there's an online difference of like how they're approached?
Yeah, and in fact, I feel that women don't even have to say anything. You wear something and there are comments on that. If a male celebrity says something or a female celebrity says something, it's so much easier to call the woman dumb.
It's one level of sexualizing, but I think we were talking about earlier and I'd like you to speak to that, which is
personal attacks.
Which is undermining,
yeah.
Right? Yeah. So there's one, on one level, it's sexualizing. On another level, it's your crap at what you do and you're stupid.
Yeah.
You know?
Which is very easy to say to women because,
And Gurmehar faced that.
So when you're young and also you're a girl and you have an opinion, all of a sudden people are like, where's the male influence? You know? Is someone polluting her mind? Nobody is polluting my mind. These are my own opinions, just by the way. And then second, this other day I received a tweet saying, she probably has a boyfriend in Pakistan. And I'm like, no, I don't. I really like Zayn Malik. just by the way, I mean, yeah.
I don't think women should always be held to a higher standard for everything, you know. So one of the things I like to say, and ladies, please take notes, is the moment a man says anything at you, just say something about his mother.
Aren't you hitting out at another woman?
Doesn't matter.
Aren't you hitting out at another woman?
No, but it's not personal.
Isn't that
patriarchal? What have you done now? You asked them to share success solutions.
You wanted to hear my lessons. Here they are. No. The reason I feel...
I mean, tomorrow if my son has a fight, someone will banning me, man. Shit.
They will.
Your mother is fat and ugly.
No, I... No one's going to say that about. No one's going to say that to your son.
Okay, I was going to actually semi like
yes,
ask you if you wanted to reframe the mother-in-law comment.
No, I don't. I don't. I'll tell you why I don't. The nuance is not. I'm not saying anything about a woman. I'm saying something about that guy's mom. It's against him. She, it's different, yeah.
No, but the end product is the mother. Yeah. And the end
you're
product.
You're looking out at another woman,
look,
then.
Though. Look, Radhika, I love you, but I can't even defend that. Yeah. Like, how to do that?
You shouldn't.
Mother.
Okay, should I start? Well, you know, actually, I'd like to say I'm very lucky and thankful to my parents that I've been brought up in a house where we had equal opportunities. But my thing on social media, I have the confidence and I have the knowledge to fight back. There are so many people who have, you know, sent messages to me, oh, don't stoop to their level and don't. I'm like, no, I'm not going to back off. These people want to intimidate you into silence. Do not keep quiet. Just bloody give it back.
Can I want to ask you, because there'll be a lot of people who will be watching this on YouTube who are very young, who will not be in a position of power slash privilege that you have because you're older, you have X amount. Because
now you're
these are
the age factor.
Like, I don't have that kind of like.
Because she does.
Yeah.
I think to reinforce what you're saying, right? I think a lot of people say, don't wrestle with pigs, right?
Yeah.
And look, my policy is a little bit different because I think there are some people who that you cannot reason with and some people who will just sort of crazy or, you know, so misogynist that. So those I block. And that's something for me that really makes it a much more calm space because honestly, I have a hell of a lot of work to do, right? Yeah. So I find, but I think engaging online is important. And so I block a lot of people. So that's one thing. But the second thing is, I think that the point Raveena is making, which is that do not fall silent. It's not that you have to shout.
Exactly.
It's not that you have to get shrill.
You don't have to say anything about their moms.
And I did not abuse that.
You don't have to say anything about their mothers.
Yeah.
The point I was trying to make was that everybody, because there are younger kids who are watching this, who will invariably fall silent because they don't have the kind of support systems. How much do you think is the role of, say, for example, parents? Now, Facebook has, for example, a fairly big problem in terms of revenge porn. And a lot of, you know, young women who obviously get shut down because they cannot tell their parents that this has happened.
If you're 16 and you are being bullied online, and if there's some, you know, video about you, if there is, you know, there are kids in the old days, there was one kid who committed suicide because of this, right?
Yeah.
So
even now that's happening.
Yeah, that's
it's a very, very important thing not to just sort of go into your shell and think you have to deal with it in your own. First thing to remember is that it is not your fault. It's not your fault and it's not just your responsibility to deal with it. It is the platform's responsibility, whether it's Facebook, whether it's Instagram, whether whatever platform it is, whether it's a service company, service delivery company. And look at their terms of service and see, well, I suppose that's very easy for me, but ask your parents to Google terms of service, you know, and see what the contract is between you and them and the terms on which you have signed up. Secondly, activate that. Get help if you're 16, you know, get help from your parents. If you're 25, maybe you can get help from a friend, but get a support system in place.
Legally, what is the support?
Legally, there's a lot. There are cyber cells. Yeah. If you're in Bombay or if you're in Delhi, like also in the other cities, Hyderabad, Bangalore, in the main cities, there are now cyber cells where you can go, you can complain. There are various different laws, right? Like one is 354A, which is sexually colored words against a woman. There's 509, which is words and gestures that outrage the modesty of a woman. There's Section 503 and Section 506, which are about threats to your person or threats to property or threats to your reputation. If somebody says that you do this thing and I will destroy your reputation. And look, a lot of this is problematic in terms of free speech. I'm going to say that, right?
No, but you know, but sometimes these
but go and file that FIR, make that complaint and then send it to the forum and get that support and do the, you know, challenge it, do the work and take it down.
There was a case recently
yeah.
where there was this person opening profiles after profiles after profiles, making fake profiles basically,
yeah.
and really like defaming this one particular person. In fact, this happened to someone I know also, something yeah. very similar. Mm. And
A, she's scared because she doesn't know how to control it once you report it. But then there was this other case, which was where this person was trying to track down and the cyber cell wasn't able to do that. So in such cases, when it's not so much about like, you know, like a war of words or you're arguing with someone, but somebody is harassing you and you have no control over it. Women live in rape anxiety, right? All of us, when we walk on a dark alley, we keep on looking over our shoulder. So when you get threats like that, they're not just something that exists online. It's something that's very real. And you can't help but feel intimidated by that. That's why women do get shut down. Because then your safety comes paramount. Or when, you know, somebody posts my number or my address online, that's when I want to quit a platform.
So there are two things, right? Like when you have a physical threat, when you have a credible physical threat, I don't think you have any other option but to go and file an FIR. I think it's really, really important.
So one sec.
Now in that situation,
so you're saying that if, say, for example, I got like a barrage of tweets from one particular harasser, not one off, but like, you know, I'm going to do this to you, I'm going to do that to you. I save those tweets and then take those and file my FIR.
You save those tweets. Also, ideally, if you don't, like, if you can do it as fast as possible so that the IP address can be traced, right? And once the FIR is filed, the police can make an inquiry of the platform, and the platform then has to disclose. Once you do have a right to anonymity, and I think it's very valuable, but once you commit the criminal offense, that right goes. Right? And so the platform needs to disclose the details. They have to disclose the details. That's one thing. The second thing, I think, in terms of safety, is that police, state governments haven't sorted out their witness protection programs yet. And that's a huge problem. And so therefore, sometimes it's about private security. And private security, the best private security is really expensive, right? So one thing is that you just have to insist that the police, and you have to just get everything at your disposal, that the police gives you some kind of protection, right? The third thing is that look for a non-bailable offense. So for example, stalking, and we're trying to see what we can do about this, but stalking at the moment is, at the first instance, bailable. How crazy is that?
Yeah.
Right? Because somebody is following you repeatedly and is threatening you and saying even that they'll rape you, this, that. Right? And you file an FIR and there is nothing that the magistrate can do about it because it is a bailable offense. It's crazy. However, in some situations, there are provisions of the IT Act, the Information Technology Act that apply, right? So, for example, there's Section 67A, which is sexually explicit and obscene pictures that are sent. So, or messages. So, if there are messages like that, that, I mean, you know, in the wisdom of the legislature, that, on the other hand, is non-bailable. So, if you have, so in that situation, you then see what is the non-bailable offense. You see if that has happened in your interaction, and then you deal with it in that manner. The third thing is that in Delhi, personal threats have become bailable. But there are other states where personal threats are non-bailable. So just remember that.
Because I think Delhi mein everybody thinks tu janta hai personal threats. It's a daily, day-to-day thing. Non-bailable kar diya toh aadhi state jail mein bhi na. Toh fir toh tab beyond the point how much.
But you know, coming back, I think to the crux of the matter is that somewhere the infrastructure, as far as safety and protection towards women, has to solidify. There's so many times that I have reported actually being threatened against rape, murder, whatever. And I actually reported it to the social media platform. And I got a reply saying, sorry, we don't find anything that offensive on this. And I've actually taken snapshots.
So give an example, like what they found not offensive.
Okay, so there's this guy who was threatening me all the time and said that we will dash you so many times that you won't have the strength to walk and open your mouth.
And what did you ask
guy from UP,
what did you ask the platform to do?
That blocked this user. He's sending me these kind of messages.
And they didn't?
They didn't.
Wow.
They didn't.
Which year was this?
This was during the tolerance debate.
So platform's mom needs to be taken.
You know, so you know, the interesting thing happened is that Twitter was going to be sold. And then they weren't bought, and a lot of the accounts, the media accounts of why they weren't bought out was because of the hate problem, because they were failing to deal with it, right? And a lot of these platforms have a bit of a nationality problem, right? Which is that, you know, when you have Robin Williams' daughter being trolled, immediately they'll come up with various safety new policies.
Because
you
she's
know?
American, yeah.
Because she's American. Here you have various women being told, you know, you'll be raped, killed, etc. And the reaction wasn't as much. This is something that is changing. I mean, we'll have to see how fast it's changing, but it is something that's changing.
Gurmehar, when you were going through your experience, did you feel like, okay, I need to sort of quit all platforms, or what kept you going?
I feel like whatever happens online is a reflection of the society. I luckily come from a very privileged place because I have been brought up with just women around me. I've seen my mother work, you know, at par with men. Second, I'm from an institution where we take pride in being women. You know, I come from a college that is straight up, they claim that we are all feminists. People who do have this privilege, they need to go up and they need to take responsibility to break those structures of patriarchy that are out there. So I think this is what kept me going. I felt like, you know, I have a social responsibility. I cannot keep quiet. The only reason why I did not go for the march that happened was because all of a sudden, the whole conversation was not about the campaign that I started, which was against nonviolence. And I realized, this is what I thought, if I do not go to that march, if I withdraw myself from the campaign, maybe then you will talk about nonviolence. So that was my thought process. It wasn't that somebody shut me down. I mean, that's not going to happen. I'm still here.
I also want to now open to questions in case anybody has any. I know that it was a heavy discussion, but there's a lot of questions. Let's start with you.
We've spoken about misogyny in this case, but don't you think there's also an underlying issue of anti-intellectualism? That, you know, in a debate, I have to be right. If I am right, you are wrong. That sort of thing is there. And I think that also channels, because like when a woman opposes you, it's not just that someone's opposing you, a woman is opposing you.
No, you know, when I think that when it's a public platform, there's a way in which you're not just having a discussion with the person, but you are demonstrating that you are having a discussion with the person.
Right? You're performing so like, an argument.
Dekha, Raveena Tandon ne mujhe block kar diya. I mean, you know, block kar diya, to then what, right?
Yeah, it's so, people wear it as a source of pride, which is very strange.
And then there's also this culture of the screenshot. Now, the point is that I may have said something in 2012, but why must I think the same thing, right? Like, surely an intelligent person keeps growing, keeps thinking about things, thinks of things also in different contexts and keeps changing their minds. And so how do we deal with this? I mean, I'm not sure we have an answer. Do you have an answer? How do we deal with this?
I think I'm always willing to admit that I'm wrong. Like, it's okay to be wrong.
That's true, actually. Nobody says that I'm wrong, actually.
Okay, so you're good at this. How do you do it?
At being wrong, yes.
You're wrong all the time. You're wrong all the time.
How do you say that you're wrong or that you've changed your mind while saving face?
I think it's a process of growing. Like, I think, like, we've all, like, said stuff in 2011 which we are not proud of because we've grown as people. So, I don't think just coming to her point, if we are wrong and if we've changed our mind about something, then we just admit that we have. And that doesn't mean that 4 years later, I might not go back to that position.
I do believe today that social media has been politically hijacked. There have been instances where, now I will say on record, where actually a spokesperson of a political party picked up a fight with me. And another MP of that party, who's a very dear friend, he said the directives that have been given to a lot of political spokespeople who are on social media is pick up a fight with a celebrity to get more eyeballs.
I just wanted to ask this question that there is always a fine line between being assertive and then being a bitch, being perceived as one. Indian men particularly, where they're not used to of seeing mostly, if I have to generalize, strong opinionated women at home. So they then come out and hear strong, intelligent women. They're like, whoa, what did just hit us, you know?
I actually want to answer that, like, not, this is my experience, is that I, funnily enough, I have had this experience with my group of my friends where a very close friend of mine said the same thing, that she's good, she's very confident, she's assertive, but thodi zyada. And I'm like, what the fuck does that mean? I genuinely felt the way I grew up. Because since we were born, the way we've been treated, we don't even realize that we are being patriarchal till somebody calls it out, till we reach that age.
Women play a very important part in the upbringing of their sons and their daughters. For example, there was this doctor with me on a panel recently. She said, you know, in the house, they've heard the mother, you know, tell the daughter, short skirt, shorts pen ke kyun ja rahi hai bahar? Chal jeans pen ya to churidar pen. You know, whereas the son is listening to this. So for him, the upbringing is that the girl who's wearing shorts is easy, while the girl who's in a salwar kameez or is wearing full jeans and a full t-shirt is the decent chick. The guys who are rapists, wife beaters, abusers, whether they are online or they are offline or in reality or have attitudes towards women, have also been brought up by a woman. We also need to influence. You know, our sons or our children, and they've been brought up by parents.
And so the attitudes are not just at home. I went to a school which was completely patriarchal. There was constant bullying from the boys. I think that's probably where I learned, what to say back. What do you think of like schools and colleges? Like, do you feel like they're not changing the game there either?
So what I felt was everything cool was constantly male. So if as a child I may have played with G.I. Joes and Barbie, but I will always disown that Barbie experience because I don't want to be frivolous to everybody. I have dissociated myself with makeup. I've dissociated with myself all things female, or I've suppressed that feminine.
It's cooler to have guy friends.
Yeah, it's always cooler to have guy friends. Like my girlfriends are fucking cool, you know?
Yeah.
Like I have amazing smart women friends, which I have now, but earlier I used to disown them. And this is something I internalized for a really long time. I saw other women who were feminine as lesser, which was as problematic, you know, because I was just buying into the same thing that I was trying to get away from.
Totally.
All right. Okay, so we really have to wrap now. 6:40. Thank you very much, everyone who came over. Appreciate it. Big round of applause for the questions. And to all the panelists who are here. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Thank you.